Elizabeth had presented Edward with five daughters and, crucially, two sons. Immortalised in stained glass at Canterbury Cathedral, they looked like the perfect royal family. Edward had what every king desired, an heir and a spare. The elder was called Edward, the younger, Richard. History would know them as the princes in the Tower. But if their parents' marriage could be proved invalid, the princes would become bastards, and Clarence would be heir once more. So the ambitious second person revived an old rumour that his brother Edward had already been married to another woman at the time he married Elizabeth, thus making the union illegal. The rumour of a previous marriage may well have been true. Certainly, bearing in mind Edward's notorious way with women, it was plausible. That only made it the more dangerous, and by throwing his weight behind it, Clarence had tested his brother's patience once too often. Clarence was arrested and put on trial before a specially convened parliament in January 1478. Edward had packed the parliament with his own supporters. He was himself both judge and prosecutor, and no one dared to speak on behalf of the accused but Clarence himself. The verdict of guilty was a foregone conclusion, and on the 18th of February 1478, Clarence was executed in the Tower. The middle brother of York was gone. But the problem he represented was not. The monarchy had been further weakened by the Wars of the Roses. Much royal land had been given away to buy support from the nobles, some of whom, like Clarence himself, had threatened to become mightier than the king. Edward needed to strengthen his own position and that of the crown. To help him do it, he enlisted a surprising ally, a man who'd spent 30 years working for the enemy. Sir John Fortescue had served as the Lancastrian Lord Chief Justice, had spent years in exile, and had been captured after Tewkesbury. But the king had not only pardoned him, he'd placed him on his council. At first sight, it's rather surprising that Edward decided to spare Fortescue. As an enthusiastic hanging judge, Fortescue had planned the judicial murder of the young Edward and the whole Yorkist family. He'd written powerfully and learnedly against Edward's claim to the throne. But Edward set these personal grievances aside. He had work for the old man to do. Fortescue, the leading intellectual of Lancastrian England, would play an important part in the construction of a new, reformed Yorkist monarchy of England. Fortescue could be called England's first constitutional analyst, his key ideas shaped by the years of exile he'd spent in Scotland and France. For his experience of how other countries were governed led him to reflect on his own and to ask a series of fundamental questions. What was unique and valuable about the English system of government? What had gone wrong with it to breed the dreadful malaise of the Wars of the Roses? And how could the disease be cured without killing the patient? Fortescue set out the answers in this remarkable book. It's usually called The Governance of England, but its full title, as it appears in this early printed edition, is The Difference Between an Absolute and a Limited Monarchy, or, in Fortescue's own lawyer Latin, Dominium Regale and Dominium Politicum et Regale. France, Fortescue says, is the supreme exemplar of absolute monarchy and England of limited. And the key to the difference between the two lies in the rules governing taxation. In France, the king could tax the common people at will, a system Fortescue strongly disapproved of, as it made the king rich but kept the people poor.
But in England, the rule, established since at least the 13th century, was that the king could only tax with the agreement of Parliament. This certainly made the English rich, with a standard of living that was the envy of foreign visitors and the boast of patriotic Englishmen like Fortescue. But did the rules limiting taxation make the English king poor? And because he was poor, weak? Fortescue thought that they did, and that this weakness was the explanation of the Wars of the Roses. The issue was the relative imbalance of wealth and power between the king and his greatest subjects, the nobility. The king was relatively poor, whereas a handful of the nobles were extremely rich, which made them, in Fortescue's phrase, overmighty.
One solution would be for the King of England to follow the path of French absolutism and impose by force taxes that Parliament wouldn't vote by consent. But such a challenge to traditional English freedom would be dangerously revolutionary. Fortescue instead proposed to strengthen the crown within the existing system of limited monarchy. The king, he said, should acquire land and rule by virtue of being the richest man in the kingdom. The execution of his brother Clarence allowed Edward to do just that by keeping Clarence's vast estates for himself.
The royal revenues from land now increased rapidly, which meant that Edward didn't need to call a parliament again for the unusually long period of almost 5 years. But land, as Fortescue also understood, was about power as well as cash. And Edward took advantage of his newfound freedom to redraw the political map.
He carved England up into territories, each controlled by a trusted member of his own household or family.
It was all very cozy, but it depended to a dangerous extent on the force of Edward's own personality. It also loosened ties of loyalty, since it meant that those outside the charmed circle didn't care very much, one way or another, about who the king happened to be.
But as long as Edward remained alive and well, none of that mattered. And for the next 5 years, the king grew rich, and his Yorkist regime grew strong. It seemed that the Lancastrian Henry Tudor, still sheltering in Brittany, would live out the rest of his life in exile. But at Easter 1483, disaster struck the House of York. Edward was taken ill with a fever after going fishing on the Thames. Within 10 days, he was dead. Only Richard, youngest of the brothers, remained. He was not his brother's heir. But soon he would make his own brutal bid for power. It is spring 1483. After the unexpected death of King Edward IV, all eyes turn west towards Ludlow in the Welsh Marches, where Edward's son, heir and namesake, Prince Edward, was being brought up. But at 12, was the boy old enough to rule in his own name? His mother thought that he was. Others thought not. And a faction emerged in favour of appointing his uncle, Richard, as protector or regent until the boy was old enough to exercise power himself. But Queen Elizabeth Woodville was determined to get her son crowned quickly, and the council agreed that the coronation should take place without delay.
On the 23rd of April, Edward left Ludlow for London, his coronation and his reign. His escort, as the council had insisted, was limited to 2,000 men. It was enough to put on a fine show as the young king took possession of his kingdom. but other of the great lords were able to muster as many men or more.
Unbeknown to the boy or his mother, Richard was summoning his own troops. He was heading south. Late on the night of the 30th of April, Queen Elizabeth Woodville, waiting in London for the arrival of her son, Prince Edward, received alarming news. Edward's cavalcade had been intercepted by his uncle Richard, who'd taken possession of his young nephew. Elizabeth, immediately suspicious of Richard's motives, fled that night with her younger son into the safe sanctuary of the Abbey at Westminster. Richard entered London with his nephew a few days later. The council quickly ratified Richard's role as protector. Young Edward's coronation was postponed until late in June, and he was placed in lodgings in the Tower.
What was Richard doing and why? Hitherto, he'd had the reputation, in contrast with the flighty Clarence, for rock-solid loyalty to his brother Edward, who'd rewarded him with the government of the whole of the north of England. There he'd won golden opinions as a fine soldier and a fair judge. Nevertheless, his portrait suggests a man not entirely at ease. He's tight-lipped and he's fiddling nervously with the rings on his fingers. He also had the tic of biting hard on his lower lip and pushing and pulling constantly his dagger in and out of its sheath. Was he repressed, paranoid, a hypocrite with an iron grip on himself? Or did he genuinely believe, in view of Edward's tangled marital history, that he, Richard, was now rightful king of England?
On the 10th of June, Richard summoned his troops to London. His bid for the crown had begun in earnest. A week later, Queen Elizabeth was compelled to give up her younger son, Richard, into his uncle's charge. The young prince now joined his brother in the Tower. Richard, both nephews, the first and second in line to the throne, under lock and key. And on the 25th of June, Parliament decreed that King Edward's marriage to Queen Elizabeth was invalid, and the princes, bastards. Richard had succeeded where his brother Clarence had failed. He'd robbed his nephews of their right to the crown and cleared his own path to the throne. He was crowned King Richard III at Westminster on July the 6th with the full blessing of Parliament. During those frantic weeks, the two princes had been seen less and less around the Tower. Now they seemed to have disappeared altogether.
By the late summer of 1483, everybody, including the prince's own mother, Elizabeth Woodville, took for granted that they were dead. They also took it as read that the responsibility for their deaths rested with Richard. For only Richard had the power, the opportunity, and, above all, the motive.
To this day, their exact fate remains a mystery. Writing 30 years later, Thomas More claimed that Richard ordered the Constable of the Tower to do them to death, but that he refused. Others, however, proved willing, and the two boys, More says, were smothered to death with pillows in their sleep. His brothers were dead.